Please join me in our unison prayer of invocation. How vast the crowds, O God, how deep their hunger, how late the hour seems, and our resources, how few and how frail. Let us, like the first disciples, entrust what little we have into the hands of the compassionate one, Jesus Christ, knowing that whatever we assemble, he will take, bless, break, and give the bread of life in abundance for us to share joyfully with all. Amen. This is the appointed time of memorial and celebration. We gather in the festival of worship to honor God. We stretch out our hands to the living God. Our souls thirst for God like a parched land. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. In life and death, in the heights and depths, God is with us. Our spirits faint within us. Our courage fails. Doubts overwhelm us, and hope is crushed. Hear once again the promises of God. Out of nothing, God creates abundance for all our needs. We lift up our souls that we may teach us. Our opening hymn is in the red hymnal, number 252, Take Thou Our Minds, Dear Lord, 252.
Thank you.
All of us need times of wrestling with God over issues in our lives. These moments of confession offer us such an opportunity. Bring your own distresses to this time of confessing, the sin in which all of us have a part. Join me in our prayer of confession. We confess, O God, that we resist change, rebel against authority, and refuse to obey. We shape our own idols and find ways to worship them. We turn from the wonders you perform among us and stop our ears against your instructions. When you give us assignments, we look for excuses and declare the tasks impossible. Free us from our self-centered perceptions, limited vision, and spiritual paralysis. We do not like what we see in ourselves and really want to change. Help us. Amen. Let us share with one another the assurance of our forgiveness. God is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love. God spares nothing to redeem us, even the lifeblood of Jesus Christ poured out on our behalf. Our Creator meets us where we are, in wilderness, in crowded places, at work or at worship, with saving grace. God teaches us the way we should go and leads us on a level path. We are set free from sin to live fully as God intends. Praise be to God. Another responsive song is Nothing But the Blood of Jesus.
A reading today comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 14, verses 13 through 21. And it tells the story of Jesus feeding the 5,000. Now, when Jesus heard about the death of John the Baptist, he withdrew in a boat to a desolate place by himself. But when the crowds heard it, they followed him on foot from the towns. When he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion for them and healed their sick. Now, when it was evening, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a desolate place, and the day is over now. Send the crowds away to go into the villages and buy food for themselves." But Jesus said, "They need not go away. Give them something to eat." They said to him, "We have only 5 loaves here and 2 fish. And he said, "Bring them here to me." Then he ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass, and taking the 5 loaves and 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and said a blessing. Then he broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the crowds. And they all ate and were satisfied. And they took up 12 baskets full of the broken pieces left over. And those who ate were about 5,000 men, besides women and children. May God bless the reading, hearing, and understanding of his holy word. Amen.
I invite the children to come forward.
Oh, you got a Bible book. Very nice. Can you get up there, Jay? And go around. Oh, you're going to go that way? Okay. Your water back there? Good. Good morning. Is everybody well this morning? It's good to see you all. Notice anything different up front here today that's not like normal? Like on a regular, like most Sundays, it's not. What's different, Olivia? What do you see? Yeah, what is that? You have any idea what that is? Do you know what's underneath that cloth? Nope. Does anybody know what's underneath that cloth? Yeah, food. You're right. It's communion. It's food. It's communion. What's communion? We're going to share communion today. Do you know what? There's two parts to communion. There's something to eat and something to drink. Do you know what? No, not water. What is it? Grape juice. That's what we drink. That's right. Do you know what that grape juice represents? We just sang about it. What does that grape juice represent? Nope, it represents the blood of Jesus. You don't have grape juice at your house? Well, we got some in these cups. Just grapes. Grapefruit. No, this is grape juice. Okay? So the grape juice, the little cup, that represents the blood of Jesus because of his sacrifice on the cross for us, the blood that came out of his body when he died on that cross for us. And then we eat something. Do you remember what we eat? Do you remember what we eat when the plate comes around? Do you remember that? Anybody remember what's in the plate? Is it fish? We just heard a story about Jesus taking five loaves and two fish and multiplying them. Is it fish? Are your moms not paying attention? They got to be paying attention, right? She's not paying attention? Well, we got moms, pay attention and wave back, moms. There we go. Moms are waving now. See, moms waving? There you go. Yeah, you have one mom, right? Daddy's working. Your dad and your mom. So underneath that cover are these big gold plates, and they have the grape juice, which represents Jesus' blood, and they have the bread. It's not fish, it's bread, and it represents Jesus' body. And we're going to share that after a while. It's called communion. And we're going to pass those plates, and people will take one piece of bread, and at the proper time, we'll take that together, and then we'll get a cup, and we'll drink the blood of Jesus. It represents the blood of Jesus, not real blood, it's just grape juice. But the bread represents his broken body, and the grape juice represents his blood. So if you believe in Jesus as your Lord and Savior, if you believe that Jesus loves you and has died for you, when that communion comes around, if it's okay with your family, then you can take communion. You can receive that bread and that cup, okay? If your family says it's okay. If they say you need to wait, then you can wait a little longer until we're sure you understand what that's all about, all right? What's it called again? What's it called that we're going to share in a little while in the service? Remember what it's called? It's grape juice and bread, and it's called communion. Communion. Yep. Okay. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for the energy and enthusiasm of these young people. We thank you for their growing faith, and I pray that you'll help each of them to truly understand your love for them. As we partake of the communion meal today, the broken body, the bread, the blood shed in the juice, Lord, help them to know of your love and faithfulness to them all throughout their lives. We ask it in your name. Amen. Thanks very much for coming up. Amen. What, you got a scratch there. How'd you get that boo-boo?
Let us pray. Lord, you have blessed us with a beautiful morning. We are here in the presence of other believers, and we are here to hear your scripture. A very familiar scripture today, the feeding of the 5,000 plus people. Jesus did many other miracles, and he's still doing miracles today. Lord, use us in any way possible to further your work of your kingdom here upon this earth in our present day. We ask it in your name. Amen. Well, today's scripture is a very familiar one. Barb sent a message the other night asking what the scriptures were, and I sent it back to her, and she said, "That's it. Yep, that's it. Just that one scripture." Because we're going to focus on that one scripture today. The feeding of the 5,000. What a miraculous event. The miracles of Jesus, and the very next one you read in the scripture, right after this, is Jesus walking on water. If any of these miracles that Jesus did today, they would meet with a lot of skepticism, would they not? People would doubt that they actually happened. And there would also be some regulations that would probably have to be attended to. With the very next one, that's Jesus walking on water, you could imagine that the disclaimer that would have to be said for legal reasons prior to Jesus walking on water would be, "Do not try this at home," okay? Especially children, right? FDA would have to approve the food. That's exactly right. Any large feeding of 5,000 or more people, they would have to, and proper handling of the food, you would all have to be, we'd all have to be wearing gloves, okay? Hair nets, right? All the things that you have to do for proper handling of food. The man born blind. Jesus does that miracle. Well, if that man was on disability, the disability would stop right then, right? And there would probably be some great questions about whether he was really should have been a recipient of that. So fraud, there'd be a fraud investigation as to whether or not he should have been receiving that in the first place, because these kind of things just don't happen. So you can see there were all kinds of, there'd be all kinds of things that would have to be with Jesus' miracles today. Friday night, well, Thursday night, we had the rehearsal for the wedding. It was at a place called Springfield Manor in Thurmont. And they told us that there were three weddings there over the course of the weekend. All the rehearsals took place on Thursday night because the wedding started on Friday, Saturday, and I guess there was one today. There were 200 and some people, like 215, 214, 215 at the wedding that I was at on Friday. And as I sat there in the dining hall, in the reception with the folks, we began to talk about what's happening, what we can't see about what's happening with this meal back in the kitchen. Can you imagine the wait staff there and the cooks for those three weddings, all at that venue over the course of, what would that be, 24 hours basically, Friday night to Sunday night, 24 hours. How busy are they? We don't see any of that. And we expect the wait staff to be polite and courteous, and they're probably worn out. Especially by today's wedding, they're going to be pretty tired from all the hustling back and forth. And in those venues, there's a lot of going around the outside because the tables are pretty close together, kind of like it was back here yesterday in the fellowship. We had fellowship following a funeral service yesterday. Well, actually, we had it before the funeral service. And we had the round tables, and there wasn't much room between the tables. So we had to even figure out how exactly to send them up for the, and Daryl's idea or Alan's idea, whoever that was that came up with that idea. It worked perfectly. We just worked our way across the room, and nobody had to be, you know, scrunching their chairs in too far. It worked really good. So, but when there's a large group, you imagine all that goes on behind the scenes. In today's scripture, there's a large group. And it is 5,000 plus people that have come to some remote location where Jesus has gone to grieve. But he's gone away, and the crowd sees that he's gone away, and they follow him. And Jesus has compassion on them, and he heals their sick. He does many more miracles. He asked the crowd to sit down. The disciples tell him, it's just about the end of the day. We got to send these folks away for something to eat. We don't have anything except these five loaves and two fish. Now, we don't know from Matthew where they came from, but we know from the Gospel of John, those five loaves and two fish came from a little boy who had them. That's all they got. There's no calling any caterer. No wait staff are going to arrive to save the day. The disciples, they're overwhelmed by this thought of trying to feed this many people out here with nothing other than these five loaves and two fish. And Jesus says, give them to me. He tells the crowd to sit down. Then he prays over them. Ask God's blessing upon those, what they have there, five loaves and two fish, and then he distributes it. There was a missionary in China years ago who, there was a famine in the country. He arranged for help to come, for food items to come, to be shipped there to help with the famine. When the items arrived, the people in the community were told that the items were here, and they stampeded the place where the items were. People were hurt and even killed trying to get to the food stuff. And then that very night he read this scripture and he realized what he had done wrong by not asking the people to sit down and come forward in orderly fashion. So the next supply of food that came, they had people sit down, then they brought them up groups at a time. We've had track and football end of season parties. You do not tell them, there's the food, go get it. Okay? The same thing would happen that happened in China years ago. There'd be stampede, right? When there's 30 boxes of pizzas sitting there and you got a bunch of teenage boys, you don't say, there's the food, go get it. You say, managers go first, they're the girls, they go first. Okay, managers go first. Then we'll start with a certain group, and we line them up that way. You don't just, it's not a free-for-all, or that's what you would get. Jesus sits the crowd down, prays over these little that they have, and then distributes it. Why? Because he's concerned for the people. They're going to be hungry. It's the end of the day. They've been here all day. Their basic needs need to be met. He is concerned for them. Barb's translation that she read explains to you why Jesus has gone to this place. In her translation, it says that when Jesus heard that John the Baptist had been beheaded. The Pew Bibles you have there just simply says, when Jesus heard what had happened, he withdrew by boat privately. So in this version, we would have to go back and read what happened. But Barb's translation says what happened. John the Baptist, his cousin, to whom he was close, has lost his life in a very tragic way. What do you think Jesus needed personally at that time when he hears about his cousin has been beheaded by Herod? What does he need? Just to go away, right? He needs his own time to grieve. If you're in the midst of grief, do you feel like you're capable of doing much to help others? No. You need your own time to grieve. But Jesus, out of concern for this crowd, though he himself is grieving, he does this miracle. He has compassion on them. Compassion. Because he knows these folks are needy. They're bringing their sick. They're maimed. These people are desperate. He has compassion on them. He proves to them in this miracle, and he proves to us, that Jesus is able to supply our every need. If he could feed 5,000 plus people on a remote hillside with what he had to work with, 5 loaves and 2 fish, then you better believe he can provide for our needs. Whether they be physical needs, emotional needs, spiritual needs, he can provide for us. We just have to sit at his feet and listen. And then trust. Can you imagine the murmur of this crowd as they also saw what little they had to work with, and as it began to be distributed by the disciples? Matthew's account doesn't say anything about what they then gathered up, but John's account does. Remember, not only was everybody filled to being full, but then they went around and gathered up the leftovers, and there were 12 baskets full of leftovers. So everyone was fed, they were filled, and then there were leftovers. What do you think, how do you think the crowd responded to that? Don't you think there was a lot of talking? Watch. You see what just happened? How is this happening? What's going on here? There had to be a lot of talking among that crowd as they witnessed this great miracle of Jesus. Lastly, Jesus used what he had to work with. As meager as it was, those 5 loaves and 2 fish, that's what he used. He didn't rain down manna. Certainly could have. That's in Scripture. That happened in the Old Testament. So Jesus would have prayed to the Father and said, send manna. Send quail. Jesus doesn't do that. He takes what he has in this particular miracle. He prays over it. And he distributes it. And everybody is fed. And there's leftovers. Jesus can take the meager that we might think we are, the meager self that we might think we are, and can do great things with our meager selves. Jesus can take what little we think we have to offer. I can't do anything in this situation. I can't do much. But Jesus will take that. And as he does here, he will multiply it, and great things will be done. Just be willing Just be willing to give of your meager self. So John can't sing. That's all right, John. We'll find a place for you in the choir. We'll tell you not to sing, but just lip sync, okay? It'll be one more person, one more body up there. It'll be all right. Or we'll let you play the cymbals or something like that. You look like the monkey. That bing, bing, bing. Don't think that you have nothing to offer. Because God can take what little we have, what we think we have, and God can multiply that for great purposes. I hope that we understand here today what this miracle means to us. Jesus cares for us as he cared for that crowd on that hillside. He cares for us deeply. He has compassion upon us. He can meet our every need. Just let him know what that need is. Cry out to him. Lord, I'm lonely. Lord, I need your help with this or with that. Dealing with this or with that going on in my life right now. I need your help. Eileen Graybell shared with me 3 weeks ago now a cousin of a family member of theirs who was involved in a lifeguard event, competition. And he dove in and he broke his neck. And he was paralyzed from the neck down. This morning she showed me a picture of that same young man standing up. He had no use of his right side. He has a thumbs up with his right hand. Slowly, he is gaining mobility. Slowly, he is coming back. It will not be as fast as he wants. He's going to need our prayers. And he's on our prayer list. He's going to need our prayers. But God is doing miraculous things still today. These are not stories from Scripture. These miracles are not stories that they don't happen anymore. They're still happening. Miraculous things are occurring. And we need to just be recognizing those things, praising God for them, as we did here today with many prayer concerns of thanks to God for things that we are seeing God do. Be willing yourselves, be willing to be a part of God's story. Each and every one of us. God can take what little we think we have, and God can use it for great purposes. Amen. Let us go before God in a spirit of prayer. Heavenly Father, we are indeed thankful for the many, many, many ways you continue to be very active in our lives, in the lives of people in your world today. You are still doing great and miraculous things. Help us to see them, to share them, to witness to your power. When people read your scripture today, they oftentimes think that these stories are fairy tales, that they don't happen, but they did happen. They are real. They are true. Help us to speak truth through the skepticism and those who lack faith. Strengthen our faith so that we might be a great witness on your behalf. And help our witness to be congruent with who we say we are. We pray for those that we've lifted up here by name, for that need your healing, for those that are in the hospital, recuperating from tragic accidents, surgeries. We thank you for answers to prayer. We pray for those that are traveling. As summer is drawing to a close, some schools are beginning to reopen, and we pray for our children and those who teach them, those who drive them, those who care for them each and every day when they are out of the care of family and in the care of a school institution. We pray for guidance for ourselves, that you help us to live in a manner that makes us available to you, believing that you are still active in doing great things in and through us. We pray for your world and for all the places where there is unrest and conflict, war. We pray for peace. And we ask you, Lord God, to speak now to each of our hearts as we quietly bring to you our own personal concerns and joys. We pray in the name of Christ as he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I invite the ushers to come forward and uncover our sacrament of communion today.
Our table is an open table. All who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of their lives are welcome to partake of the sacrament when it's brought to you. In the bread trays are gluten-free wafers for anyone who might have an allergy to gluten products. And it is grape juice and not wine today. Our Lord Jesus Christ made this sacrament an institution within his church to remind us of his sacrifice on our behalf, his love for us. As we partake of it this day, may our hearts be open to receive the gift that he's offered. Let us pray. Awesome, powerful, amazing God, you are still doing great things in your world today. One of the greatest is the way your church has been sustained throughout history. In the midst of persecution, there were those that wanted to silence your voice. You did not allow that to happen. In our world today, there are those that want to silence the work of the church. We know you will not allow that to happen. Equip us for ministry on your behalf. And as we partake of this sacrament, as we receive these gifts today, strengthen our faith and our resolve to be witnesses on your behalf wherever we are. We ask it in your name. Amen. Behold, the living bread come down from heaven. Those who eat it will never die. Behold, the cup of eternal life. Those who drink it will live forever. These are the gifts of God for us, the people of God. Come, for all things are now ready. Take and eat this living bread from heaven. Amen.
Yeah. Take and drink.
Take and drink the cup of God's blessing. Amen. I invite those who are able to stand and join in our prayer of thanksgiving. Strengthened by the living bread that Christ has given us, we go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Our closing hymn is in the red hymnal number 204, Break Thou the Bread of Life. Let us share in our unison benediction. Jesus blessed and broke the food of sharing, and there was enough for all. Give what you can. Christ gave life itself on our behalf. That love sustains us today. Share what you receive. God's steadfast love renews each morning. God's presence is sure in all times and places. Go in peace and serve the Lord.